And the idea is to look into the future by way of the past also, not really the future, but I mean, what can we learn today about what happened yesterday? And I was starting with the inspiration we had at IFE, at the university, where we had Kristen Nygaard and Scandinavian approaches as part of our basic development of the IFE, in fact. And the key thing here was his and the Scandinavians' approach to system development, which was focused on participatory design and democratic technology development. And there's some traditions back there from working with the unions. It was a project in the 70s with the Kristen, and actually which led to new working life agreements in Norway, where workers were then from then onwards allowed to negotiate the introduction of new technologies, because at that time workers and jobs were threatened by new technology. And yeah, typical example is in graphical workers, typographical tools. And a big project in Sweden was linked to making new tools for the graphical workers. And they developed many methods and approaches for participatory design. And what they actually wanted to develop is what suddenly was there, namely the desktop publishing. So it was not successful because it was overruled by development. Anyway, the HISP and the DHIS approach was to adapt the Scandinavian approaches to the context of developing countries. And that was the starting point for the HISP project. And it was more to develop things in the South and empowerment in the South than actually health in the beginning. But health was where this could happen, because the health sector is huge and you have all kind of use situations, and it's very data intensive. So it's actually started in South Africa in that way. Just a couple of words about what this participatory design is, some basic principles. Generally, it's about including future users in developing and designing the technical solution. And the idea is, the democratic part is then that the future users should have a say in developing the technology and be part of designing the future working conditions. And to involve users in all parts of the process. That's the key part. And mutual learning is important here, in that you learn together while developing things together. And rapid prototyping is a very important part of this approach in HISP, where you can have many different participatory design techniques around developing a real system in real context. And to build working prototypes, that's actually the trademark of the HISP participatory design approach. And with that, and start with some low-hanging fruits and make sure that there are some early results, and thereby learning by doing. That's kind of how HISP has accommodated or actually adapted the participatory design approach then. So it started in South Africa when Mandela created, he became president, and new South Africa, new post-apartheid South Africa started then. HISP was actually part of what was then called the Reconstruction and Development Program, through being part, I had scholarship and worked with the, and was actually staying in Cape Town and worked with the University of Cape Town and later also University of Western Cape. And through those contacts, we became part of this new reconstruction and development program. And information was seen as key. And the reason why information was key in the new South Africa was that it was a lot of differences and the opposite of equity in all respects between ethnic groups, across geographies, and all those different differences between racial and ethnic groups that you know and have maybe still remember from what you learned about apartheid. So local use of information was important because that was a way to empower the users, empower the, those who were kind of oppressed through apartheid should now be empowered through being able to have their say in local governance. That was the idea from the ANC at that time. And translated into system development, which was about bottom-up design and participatory design. And it was a lot of work. I mean, it started in 94, but the real first version of the database, DHIS version 1, was tested and implemented around 97. And then in 98, it was a big push in many provinces from there on. And it's developed into national implementation around 2000. So it was a long process. And important was that the participants in this process were, from the beginning, a lot of people who have been in the anti-apartheid movement. So it was a kind of a progressive movement, and being part of this RDP, as it was called, and that was kind of important part of how the geist of the HISP developed in the beginning. And one thing I became more aware of recently, and I wanted to highlight, was that the key part of the national health plan for South Africa, I mean the ANC, African National Congress, Mandela's party's health plan, that was to build everything on the foundation of the health districts. The districts were seen as the foundation for decentralized, comprehensive primary health care, and it should include then district authorities who should then coordinate and manage hospital services, health programs, health centers, community health, etc. And that was then the important part of the changes in South Africa to create these health districts that were created across all these old Bantustans and homelands that we call this crazy things of the apartheid. And also then of course that's why DHIS is called DHIS district, but not only district, it's district health system in fact. So this is the background for the naming also. And if you look at the visions of how this health district should transform the health system, you see here just one example from the pilot project, one of the districts in the pilot in the HISP pilot in the 90s, Atlantis. The typical system was that the data flows were only going out of the district, so there was no local use of data. It was kind of a very oppressive and depressive system because they were actually disempowered at the district level in the old South Africa. And the idea was then, by creating this district, then you should change the data flows and you should focus on a, say, a district database and district management. This was another all drawing from the district approach. And you see here that the idea was that all these different programs, data from the programs, data from community, data from all the clinics, hospitals, all services, etc., should be integrated through this district approach. And what we learned when we tried to look closer at how the district used DHIS here just before the COVID started in Rwanda, Mozambique, etc., we found actually that data was used, but they were not really able to do these things of combining data from different sources, calculating indicators, etc. And I will come back to that later. I mean, the facility profile is one thing that is not that easy to carry out in the current situation in the DHIS and in the countries. And maybe more importantly than that, we don't really have this cross-program dashboards, and we don't really have good denominators to calculate indicators. So that is one of the reasons why I mentioned that it's possible to look into the past in order to learn what we can do now around this area. So if we go back to the movement of the history, then the DHIS first version moved to India and Mozambique mainly from 2000. And also other countries in Africa from then, because at the same time we were able to recruit a lot of HISPers through a NORAD program for developing masters in Mozambique, South Africa, Malawi, Tanzania, Ethiopia, and Sri Lanka. And a lot of students were enrolled in these programs, and once finished with their master, they started with the PhD, etc., to run these master programs. And all of these students were engaged in starting various DHIS pilots in their home countries and in other countries. So that's kind of a big movement, many pilots, and but they were very difficult to sustain and scale in countries in this pre-online period, because of course these were Microsoft Office and standalone system. And sometime around 2000 and a bit later, 2003-04 or something, it was a secret evaluation in South Africa and Mozambique, where the enemies of DHIS criticized it for not being three-tier and not professional, etc., which then led to the start of the DHIS 2, then the web-based DHIS 2. And we actually created an open source master course at IFE in 2004, which then were the foundation for the development of the DHIS 2 for a long time, in fact. And at this period, and the research and education and working with all these countries were a very important part of what HISP were doing. And we had what we normally call, the three pillars. Then one is to work and do research on health information systems. That is about integration standards, architecture, use of information for decision making, etc. Then there's free and open source software. That's the DHIS 2, and how to share it and how to include groups in the countries, his groups in the countries to take part in the development, to take part in its implementation. And of course, education and research, the basis for the work at the university with masters, PhDs, training and courses, etc. And what kind of emerged out of this situation was that the DHIS 2 actually got funded from EU. It was something called the sixth framework program in the around 2006, 2009 or around there. And we called it BINISH. And that was a building Europe Africa network in information system, I think it was. It was a requirement to have a fancy acronym, and that was fancy enough. And the first DHIS2 started out with the overall conceptual design of the what was then the DHIS 1.4, which was an overhaul of previous DHIS 1 versions. And it was actually implemented first on a big scale in Zanzibar, and Ola knows everything about it because he stayed there for 1 year and working in that project. And when it comes to the DHIS 2, the first pilot were in Kerala in January 2006. And it's still, I mean, the improvement from the DHIS Microsoft standalone was not that significant in that there were no online web-based system yet, possibilities. I mean, the internet was not that strong. So the ongoing debate with Kalle and the team in South Africa, when they claimed that their standalone version was actually better, they were probably very right in that, because for every implementation, you had to then implement servers, etc., in the PCs around in the district. So anyway, it was the DHIS2, it was web-based, although not having good enough internet to benefit from that. And at the same time, then we increased our profile significantly by working with the WHO and Health Metric Network, which Health Metric Network, HMN, was a very, very, very important part in the development of the information system in the Global South, starting, I think, 2007, 2006, until 2010, I think it broke down because they were disagreeing between HMN and the WHO, who should get the money and all that. So, but it did some great work during its existence. And actually, they initiated and conducted assessment and strategic planning in 50 or more countries in Africa and all over the world. I think it's actually much more than 50, but Johan is the one who is actually knowing everything about that. So we need to get the concrete figures from him. And that's an important part, because we had our well-known HISPers, Ola, Knut and Johan, working with and at this HMN and WHO. And very important also is that the HMN architecture was very well aligned with the DHIS2 conceptual design. So it was very easy when we got the question then in 2007, whether we could use DHIS2 to pilot this new architecture, data warehouse architecture, data repository architecture in Sierra Leone. And of course we said yes, no problem. And this is the HMN architecture, which I think was extremely productive for the DHIS2's rollout and scaling across the globe, because it's very, very similar to the conceptual design of the DHIS2. You take data from different sources and you put it into a repository and you produce graphs and dashboards and all that. And we produced this drawing then to show them that actually this was a more realistic version of their own architecture. So I think that was a very, very important step forward. And you can say that at this point in time, the standing of DHIS 2 was quite significant. I mean, I mentioned that we had people like Knut and Ola and Johan working in Geneva and was part of this. And for actually some time. And I think that has been very, very important in the success of the DHIS too. And when HMN closed into having to close down, then they declared DHIS 2 in Sierra Leone as a big success, mainly maybe because there were not so many successes they had to brag about. So they declared it anyway a success. And when HMN closed down, then immediately after that, around 2010, 11 or something, it was 50, at least 50 countries that were working, and they had their assessment, and they were working on strategic plans, largely based on this HMN architecture. And I think that's also a very, very important part that, for example, what I will come back to later is that Kenya was one of the countries that had made their strategic plan, and suddenly all the HMN, et cetera, disappeared. And that was part of the reason why they came to the DHIS. But at that time also, we had a very close collaboration with other global health informatics actors like OpenMRS, IRIS, and others. We had in 2010, it was an interoperability workshop in Accra. And where all these partners were, WHO, OpenMRS, IRIS, and others. And that was then the start of our collaboration with WHO and Tomeka. And basically based on the fact that he said that if Sierra Leone can implement DHIS 2, then any countries in any country in West Africa can do that. Because if you remember back then, at the time we implemented DHIS 2 in Sierra Leone, it was not long after the civil war and all this blood diamond stuff. So it was not a very conducive, generally speaking, environment for system development. Anyway, so my reason for mentioning these different global issues and actors is, if you go back to say, look at the standing of DHIS 2, we can call it discursive strengths, discursive formation, influence. At this point in time, at the start of what would be the big scaling up, we can say that the standing of DHIS 2 was in the global health informatics crowd, it was very high. We were working and having hackathons and interoperability workshops, etc., together. In the country health authorities and the Minister of Health, it was not that high, but it was increasing. And interestingly, in the donor community, it was very low. It was no donors funded DHIS 2 or HISP or anything like that at that time. It was EU, this framework program, which was not linked to, it was research and it was not linked to the donor community at all. And so I think that is interesting to, we can look at how is it now. I think maybe the global health informatics crowd, our standing there is considerably lower now than it was then, but in the donor community, very high. So it might be interesting to see how these different measures of discursive strength or standing is developing through time, and maybe they are a forerunner for what will come later. So my reason for mentioning this, it might be very important to work to strengthen our standing or discursive strength in the global health informatics crowd, which is a lot of fighting there now. Of course, at this time we're talking here, that was the aggregate data era, so we didn't fight over the same turf. So I think maybe that is why the fighting is a bit harder now, where the tracker and all that. So anyway, that's another discussion. Interesting things happened at the time of the implementation in Kenya, which everybody have heard about. But what happened was that the cables around Africa finally came, and we were actually for the Kenya project, we got an invitation from Kenya, from Danida, in the end of 2010, and we went, Lars and I and Ola also, to Kenya, and we worked with the Minister of Health in Kenya. But still, it was not yet the vision of having an online DHIS2. So when we started to set up the DHIS2 in Kenya, and we wanted to actually test the internet then. But the idea was to have standalone implementation across the country. We went to a neighboring small town and tested it in the hospital, and we were testing the internet and launched the DHIS2, and it worked fine. But suddenly we saw that it was a power cut, and after the power cut it was didn't come up again, and we just realized that it was not possible to implement online. And we were just on the way out when it was actually a Japanese volunteer that was with us. And he said, why don't you use this? And he put up what turned out to be what he called a dongle. And that was connection to the mobile internet. And we plugged it in a laptop and fired it up, and it worked perfectly. And then first did we realize that it was possible to do this online implementation in Kenya and in Africa. And what emerged was that what had happened was that they had got this, they had pulled the cable from Mombasa up to Nairobi just immediately before our test here. And we, over the next month, the people were testing the internet all over Kenya, and it turned out to be very fine. And then the DHIS2 was implemented in Kenya. And that was actually what triggered a lot of work. It was a lot of work. Actually, the whole, with Lars and the whole team, moved literally to Kenya and followed up 24/7 over quite some time. Over the whole 2011 to get the implementation right, because Danida was pulling out. So they really wanted to finish everything over the first year. So, and that was what happened. And also had the first DHIS2 Academy in Mombasa, and that helped scaling to other countries like Rwanda, Uganda, Tanzania, etc. So important in this scaling was that the work with West Africa, that's WAHO, and the ESC, has been very, very important in enabling the implementation all over West Africa and all over East Africa. For example, working with ESC, they said, but Burundi hasn't implemented DHIS. We will help you to implement DHIS. And in East Africa, Tomé, who is Portuguese speaking, he has been irritated for a long time over the only country in West Africa not using the DHIS2, that's Cape Verde. And finally, he managed to get it implemented also in Cape Verde from a couple of years back. So this regional approach has been extremely important in scaling of the DHIS. And this is just a map showing the different regional HISP, West Africa, South Africa, East Africa, India, and in Vietnam and Sri Lanka. So the regional approach has been important. And I just wanted to show this kind of development in Africa, maybe people are not fully aware. I said that when we came to 2010, we had a very, very strong standing in the HMN, and people were making the strategic plan all over Africa, etc. But at the same time, we had a mobile explosion with the subscribers in Africa. You see here, increasing 2008, 2009, 2010. And then we have the bandwidth in Africa, also increasing around 2010, 2011. And of course, then we have the implementations of the DHIS2, which is kind of directly correlating with the bandwidth. But without the strong standing and the HMN and the fact that all countries were making their plans on the one hand, and on the other hand, that we have been struggling with the DHIS2 in the most difficult context in Africa, like Sierra Leone, and also in India for already many years. All this made it possible to hit the ground running, as one might say, and to fully kind of use the opportunity by the new internet revolution. And just a little comment on the principles we developed a couple of years back, to put it that way. I think it's very, very recent. And I wanted to mention it now, that free and open source software and training and education material is a very, very important part of the HISP DHIS2 community principle. I think it's might be important to highlight that now that we get all these other softwares, applications and systems and what you have, all calling themselves global goods. I think it's important to highlight that we are actually not only global goods, we are free and open source. So that's one thing, and then empower the communities, etc. But another thing which I will come back to now is that important is the developmental approach to capacity building and research, and to engage users, HISP groups, and others in action research. And then I turn to current challenges, because we have a new project in HISP, and that is to work on improving data use, assess what might be improved, what is wrong, and what can be better. And we started out before this COVID thing, and had an assessment in Mozambique, Rwanda, Tanzania, Kenya, and also in Laos and Indonesia. But particularly East Africa showed that the DHIS data was used, but DHIS2 dashboards and visuals were not used. Why? Because it was of many things, but denominator data were always problematic to get for the facilities. And what we can call last mile features, they are not there. I mean, what makes it possible to really use the dashboards? So the new project is to revitalize the participatory design and what we can call the district data use by follow-up countries and support countries, and also to see how we can engage countries in action research, and to collaborate and support app development where roadmap is too slow and not precise enough, and to help countries to build apps. That's the idea with this. Because if you look at the general picture of the development participatory design in DHIS2 is that you have a local use and participatory design in the country, and then you feedback via the roadmap, etc. And then your new requirement is coming in the next release, etc., etc. What we have seen is that this is too slow to really help action research and participatory design when you are stumbling in something concrete. And that's where this custom app development comes in, which we will try to work on and support countries in doing. And we also have a design lab at IFE with students, etc., that we will try to involve in that. Just a few examples from our assessment. This is just an example of what is used at the district level in Mozambique, in one district we visited. And they were all, in all their kind of dashboards and displays, they used Excel. They took data from the DHIS2, copied, downloaded, and put it into Excel. And we asked, I mean, why not dashboards? Why can't we use that directly in DHIS? Because denominator data and target data is not in the DHIS, because it's kind of contested. Budgets are made based on that, and you can't really change it. So that is a big problem. Denominator data is a big problem. Same in Rwanda. They have routine monthly data use and evaluation meetings in districts, hospitals, health facilities. Every month they are meeting and they are discussing data. How is DHIS used? What can be improved? That was our question. Data from DHIS is everywhere, but DHIS dashboards and analytics are not really being used. Again, the problem is denominator and target data for the facilities is a recurrent problem. And reason here is not politics, but facilities have their own data of target data, and they are kind of crossing numerator areas, etc. So it's always a bit complicated. That's a typical last mile thing to make sure to have this. And obviously we should make it easier for locals to operate with the alternative denominator data. And we have a group, WhatsApp group, working in Rwanda now and discussing features. A lot of the requirements is about adding text and reports and calculating indicators, etc. But we see that custom apps are possible to develop on many of these issues, but many of these things cannot really be made a feature in the DHIS. This is one example where it's not so easy to make a generic feature in DHIS. Typical example of a last mile problem where what they want to mix colors and texts in a table. So that's the challenge then, to maybe make and also to make reports, etc. So that's one of the challenges we will work on with the design lab then to support countries to develop custom apps.